Hello, this is Murat Yılmaz from the School of Computing at Dublin City University. Today we will do a quick recap of use cases based on the lecture that we already had in the synchronous class. So I'm going to give you a quick review of the things that we have talked. So we learned about the use cases, which brings out the users of the system. So use cases help us to identify the actors, which means that the users who are interacting with the system. So the use case diagrams help to define the roles of the actors. So there would be several types of roles which can be defined in the use cases. And ultimately, the goal of the use cases is this, creating, showing the services and interaction between the users, which are drawn in a form of a use case diagram. Very often, these are the first diagrams initially started to be drawn when you start to initiate the system and start working on the requirements analysis. So let's see an actor here as a patient. So as you see, there's a kind of an oval there, which has the functional requirement inside, which we can see make an appointment. And there is a communication line between these and the patient. So, and we can consider it as the part of the use case, but the use case will be represented by having some sort of a appointment making system or a part of the system. So, well, we can have more than one actor on the system, and this could be the case in most of the time. So we could have a scheduler, a doctor, and a clerk here. So scheduler could be a human. At some stages, it might be maybe a machine, but still the abilities of a patient and the scheduler has two commonalities. One is canceling an appointment and the other is making one. However, for the doctor and the patient, there is only one commonality of requesting medication. This shows that a patient who might have a chronic illness periodically needs to get some sort of medicine, which can be requested by the doctor. And a doctor also might request a medicine, a medication for his or her patient. And we have the clerk, which can be also connected with paying the bill, as like the clerk and the patient are using the same functional requirement as paying the bill. So here you might consider a kiosk that you go further and try to pay a bill, which can be found in a quite standard in the hospital and similar systems. We have different diagrams than the use cases. So let's look at these different diagrams, at least see a class diagram here. In a class diagram, you can see the classes. We consider them as cookie cutters, as previously mentioned. So the objects can be constructed like cookies, and we have these cookie cutters, which will be looking like templates for us. So we can create several objects based on these classes. So here, like we can see the customer class, and ultimately there would be states and the behavior of any class. So here we only have the state, we don't have the behaviors. So customer class is directly connected with an order class, which shows that an order should at least one customer, which means that if you want to order something, you need to become a customer at some stage. And here what we can see, you can be a customer, but you might not have any order. So it can be zero, or you can have multiple orders to and orders as you can have as much as you can. So the orders needs to be paid, and it should be have a relationship between the payment class. So here our payment class is an abstract class, which has the three different types of payment: cash, check, and credit. So the amount here can be a common state for all of these different types. But all different types of abstract classes have different types of states, which can be unique to themselves, plus some other functionalities like authorized, like being authorized or having the authorization abilities. So for the cash, probably we don't need anything like this, but for the check and the credit, it could be one of the possibilities. So the order can be in a form that can be aggregated through Any other directions, such as like details or other things that goes further through, and an order should at least have like one detail. So there should be some details, like for example the quantity of the order, perhaps the tax status of the order, and there would be several other behaviors like calculating the subtotal, calculating the weight, and the calculating the tax. So order details can also be having an association relationship with an item. So and every, at least an item should have some sort of order details here. So an order detail should have an item. An item could have an order detail or could not. It depends on several forms. Here, as you can see, there is the class name, attributes, and the operations. So use cases specify only what system is supposed to do, actually, and the system's functional requirements. So they do not specify what system shall not do, like system's non-functional requirements, or sometimes known as the constraints. Non-functional requirements, on the other hand, often include performance targets and programming, like, for example, programming languages, or abilities or quality attributes can be organized here based on the stakeholders' needs and requests. It's even better when a requirement is presented as a use case and a stakeholder sees that that requirement has a little or no value to the system. So these diagrams helps them to understand or see the functionality's values for them. If a stakeholder can discard unnecessary requirements, at this point, both money and time could be saved. So it is always a challenge to identify the actors, especially for the people who started this job as a newbie. So like actors don't have to be actual people. So there could be several different forms of actors. Could be a persons, could be a system itself, could be something that could be able to make a decision actually and just interact with the system to get some sort of a decision. So actor can be considered as a black box, and you cannot change an actor, and you're not interested in how it works, but it must interact with the system. So that's the important part. Let's see how we can identify the actors here. So firstly, we identify a thing from the requirements, and then we check, is this thing an actual person interacting with the system? If it's a yes, it would probably be an actor. Is the thing something that I can change within the system's design? When I change the system design, do you think that thing could change as well? If it's a no, the thing is ultimately an actor. So it could be, when it comes to people, sometimes people can be considered as a part of the system. You should be able to see either this is an actor could be a part of the system or not. The thing is probably not an actor at the case of which it can change with the system design and that you can affect and have some control over when designing your system is likely to be considered as a part of the system. So the challenge is finding either a person or a thing could be inside the system or outside the system. So that's usually be done by quite often with stakeholder meetings and discuss with other people, and their thoughts should be taken. So here is an interesting example for you. System clock, which comes into play when it invokes a behavior within the system. Well, it's hard to determine. It's a kind of a challenging example. A system clock is an actor because the clock is not clearly outside of your system. It is inside. However, the system clock is often best described as an actor because it's not something that you can influence based on your system design or change in the system. In addition, like describing the clock as an actor will help demonstrating that your system needs to perform a task based on the current time. So actually we don't see several actors like system clock. This is an example for you to see something that is different than the others. Most of the time, other elements could be easy to identify, which needs to be interact with the system. But system clock could be inside of the system and still considered as an actor because we cannot alter it. There is a standard UML core conventions that we can take a look at. So, and UML diagrams denote graphs of nodes and edges, nodes are the entities drawn as rectangles. Like you can see, normally the functional requirements can be in ovals, written down in the ovals. Most of the time, rectangles denote classes or interfaces. And names of the classes are not normally underlined, but the instances, if you see any diagram with an underlined form, this is usually means it's an instance. An edge between two nodes denotes the relationship between the corresponding entities as well. So here's another use case to represent the functionality of the system. As you see, course is the system boundary, which can be act as a classifier. And as we can see, there is an actor, there's a group of actors, including instructors, teaching assistants, and a student. So instructor is by definitions giving the lectures, which also can be done, like which also be interacting with like a teaching assistant, also could be interacting with the system as form of giving lecture. And like most of the time, like what happens is the student should be able to access to this lecture as well. And the teaching assistant here can be able to give the lecture or hold the exercises, and like student could be able to access all. And one thing, apart from the other actors, there is usually something that you need to show on the diagram that like do homework, which should be unique to an actor. If we take this out, then what happens is like all the actors are using the same functionality. So there should be some different functionality for some of the actors. Otherwise, we should reconsider our decisions or selections about the actors as well. So the use case diagrams represent the functionality of the system from the user's point of view. So like there's a package diagrams as well, which you can see here, like there's the watch user and there's a watch repair person, which as you can see, they can be able to read the time and set the time of a watch, but the repair person could be able to change the battery. So that's a kind of a unique ability for what watch repair person could, which he or she could do it. So it's a kind of thing that is shown from the user's point of view. So this is another representation. So with class diagrams, what happens is we can show the simple watch here with having these different components of this. So there's the association, class, and multiplicity components here. So push button could be in a simple watch. We can have two push buttons according to this model. And as we can, we have only one display and two batteries and one time panel which shows the time perhaps. So this is a quite abstract formation, but still when we start our class diagrams, we can start drawing things at this level. And further, we can extend our understanding by talking with users, looking at the use cases while we're trying to build the class diagrams. Here, what you can see is there is the push button with respect to watch, and there's states and behaviors like push and release. So these are all a part of the classes that are represented in any class diagram. So we also call them the attributes, as you can see on the LCD display. And there are the operations that can be done by the LCD display. And ultimately, if you see only a single variable like state, load or now, they are usually showing as an attribute or a state. And as you see, like blink seconds, blink minutes, and the other stuff usually shows the behavior actually. And this is a sequence diagram. In the sequence diagram, usually we see objects on the actors here. We have the watch user. And as the time goes further through, this is usually sequence diagrams are a little bit based on time events. And we can see here the watch user could be interacting with the watch by pressing a button. And then LCD display blinks the hours. And then furthermore, the actor could be able to press the button again, and it blinks the minutes, and pressing the button too will increment the minutes. And then further, the time changes and we refresh the display. The things will be shown in the LCD display. Further, like for the activation part, as you see, it goes as a flow further through, and the actor pressed the button land two during the activation phase, and then the actor could be able to commit new time. And The LCD display, another message could be go further for the LCD display, then it's the watch stopped blinking. So this is the end of the operation. So the lifespan of the all actors and the objects would probably end at this point. So here's a state chart diagram, which will be different than the other formations. Still, we're looking for the same watch here. The initial states represent here as a black dot here, and blink hours is the first state in the hour state diagram. So when we press the button two, it increments hours, and there's a kind of a two-way communication, as you can see. And like blinking hours can button one and button two is pressed, and the state it can take to stop blinking state. And if we further go through pressing button one again, we can blink the minutes. And one more blink, one more press to button one and two pressed, and then we can stop blinking. Further, by using the button two, we can increment the minutes, as you can see here. And further, we can go further through to pressing the button one and again blink seconds. We can see we can increment the seconds as the button two pressed.